Open up the public hearing, and we'll open it up at 6:16. So the first item on the agenda is introduction, or roll call, Ms. Padilla.
Dr. Lowell Stripe.
Present.
Mr. Christopher Williams.
Here.
Mr. David Montemayor.
Here.
Ms. Melissa Myers.
Here.
Ms. Leanna Harding.
Here.
Mr. Jason Olson.
Here.
And not present, Mr. DeLeon English and Mr. Alejandro Flores.
Thank you, Ms. Padilla. Okay, the third item on the agenda is the presentation of the annual financial management report. Mr. Anderson.
Good evening, Board of Trustees and Superintendent and Little Elm Community. Already technical.
It's Monday.
We did a presentation of the first reading. Are you running it? Okay. The first reading was established by the legislature in 1999 to achieve quality performance in the management of school district financial resources. And this is our 2015 school first financial accountability rating system. It was implemented in 2003 and changed in August of 2015 in the 83rd legislature. The three phases requiring separate worksheets for the 2015, 2016, and 2017, which occurred this year, was implemented this year. And this year's presentation is from last year's data, which includes 7 indicators. And assigns the financial ratings of pass or fail for each of the 7 indicators. And I listed them here. The indicator 1 is the audit was submitted on time and Little Elm passed. Indicator number 2, the audit was presented was unmodified in its opinion from our auditors. Little Elm passed. Indicator number 3, debt paid on time. Little Elm passed. Indicator 4, unrestricted net asset had a balance greater than 0. Little Elm passed. Indicator number 5, administrative costs were below the threshold. Little Elm passed. Indicator 6, PEAMS submitted with acceptable variances. And that's the data that's collected through a system and sent to TDA. And Little Elm passed. Indicator 7, the audit was free of material weakness. And Little Elm passed. And out of the 30 points possible, Little Elm received all 30 points. Now, this is very anticlimactic. You got all the goodness up front. And now, by legislature, we have to go through each indicator in a public hearing and read each indicator and poll. Question 1 was the complete annual financial report and data submitted to Texas Education Agency with 30 days of January 28 for school districts with fiscal year ended August 31. The answer yes. Prior year indicator, which we also by legislature have to disclose in the public hearing, yes, the answer was yes. Indicator 2, and yes means that we passed. Indicator 2, question, was there an unmodified opinion in the audit in the annual financial report on the financial statements as a whole? Answer, yes. Prior year indicator, it was indicator number 5. The answer also was yes, which means passed. Indicator number 3, question, was the school district in compliance with the payment terms of all debt agreements at fiscal year end? The answer, yes. Prior year indicator 3, yes. Indicator 4, question, was the total unrestricted net asset balance net of the accretion of interest for capital appreciation bonds in the governmental activities column in the statement of net assets greater than 0? The answer is yes. In prior year, that was indicator number 2, and the answer is yes, which we passed. And this is just a column of just showing that the net assets was greater than 0. Indicator 5, question, was the school district's administrative cost ratio equal to or less than the threshold? Answer, yes. Threshold was less than or equal to 0.10. LASD's ratio was 0.08. We got a total of 10 out of 10 points. Prior, that was indicator number 15. And in that year, there was 5 points. We received all 5 points. Indicator 6, They're the comparison of public education information management system, which is PIMS data, to like information in the school district's annual financial report result in a total variance of less than 3% of all expenditures by function. The answer is yes. LASD's variance is pretty much none. We got 0, 10 out of 10 points.
Prior year indicator was 8.
We got 5 out of 5 points.
The last indicator question, did the external independent auditor report that the annual financial report was free of instances of material weakness in internal controls or financial reporting and compliance of local, state, and federal funds?
The answer is yes. We received all 10 out of 10 points.
Prior year, this was indicator number 6.
Last year.
The summary is that they answered yes to the first four indicators, which means that we passed all the first four indicators. We scored 30 out of 30 possible for the indicators 5 through 7, and the grade we received was a pass.
In the first rating transparency data, this is also required to be held in a public meeting and disclosed to the public. That the superintendent employment contract has been posted on Little Elm ISD's website at www.littleelmisd.net/2207. And reimbursements received by the superintendent and board members have been posted on Little Elm ISD's website. Superintendent received no outside compensation or fees for professional consulting and or other personal services has been reported by the superintendent for the 2014-15 fiscal year. No gifts have been reported by the board members or superintendent for the 2014-15 fiscal year. No business transactions between Little Elm ISD and the board members have occurred for the 2014-15 fiscal year. And this reimbursements, which have been received by the superintendent and board members, are also on our website. You can see that on all the information for each board member and the superintendent position. That's it. Any questions?
Okay. Do we have any questions? This is open for the public if they. This is a public hearing, so if we have any questions or comments from the public. Okay. Thank All right, you. Well, then we will close this meeting at the public hearing at 6:23. All right, good evening again. We're going to get started for the regular meeting of the Board of Trustees. So I call the meeting to order at 6:31. Our first item on the agenda is the Pledge of Allegiance, so if you'll please stand. Dr. Mika, who was going to lead us in the pledge?
The students from Brent.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The Texas flag?
Under the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you. Next for our invocation, Mr. Rodney Harris, please.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight. We ask you to help guide our elected leaders and our school officials in making good, sound decisions. We ask you to bless each and every one of these children and family represented here tonight. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Chief Harris. Ms. Video, roll call once more, please.
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Lowell Strike.
Here.
Mr. Christopher Williams.
Here.
Mr. David Montemayor.
Here.
Ms. Melissa Myers.
Here.
Ms. Leanna Hardy.
Here.
Mr. DeLeon English.
Here.
Mr. Jason Olson.
Here.
And that present, Mr. Alejandro Flores.
Thank you, Ms. Badillo. Do we have any citizen input?
We do.
Okay, Okay, before we get started on the citizen input, I would just like to remind everybody that this is for the person who signed up for them to speak, but there can be no participation from any other members in the audience or from the board. So it is literally just for them to come up and speak, and then we thank them. So at this time, Jack Eichert, is that correct? Thank you.
Well, hello everybody. My name is Jack Eichert. I'm here to discuss the double blocking English at the middle school. And so first I would like to start off with how English is graded. So first of all, if you you exceed progress if your gain score, and this is for grade 7 English, if your gain score is over 124, and or if your raw score is between, like, you miss between 40, if you get between 48 to 50 questions right. And I know many people at my school, myself included, that we consistently miss less than 2 questions on, like, consistently every year. Like, just for an example, here are my scores for since 4th grade. And in reading, in 4th grade, I met standards, which I missed the exceeded progress by 1 question, which means that I got 41 questions right. And 5th grade, I exceeded, and 6th grade, I exceeded as well. There are many other kids like that at our school who they have exceeded consistently. And what they've been telling us at the middle school is they are putting us in tutoring and we need double blocked English because we need to improve our scores. But it doesn't benefit our school at all even if we do improve. Because even if we get perfect, we're still in that exceeded progress range. And yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, well, that will end citizen input. So now we will move on to the approval of minutes. So I need a motion to approve the public hearing minutes from February 8th of 2016.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Any questions? All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. Did you?
Absent.
Okay.
Here, so.
All right. Now I need a motion to approve the workshop meeting minutes from February 8th, 2016.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Any opposed?
One accused.
Motion carries. All right. Item number 7, Superintendent Spotlight. So I'll hand the mic over to Dr. Strike.
Thank you, President Hardy. I'd like to introduce the principal, Brett Elementary, who will take care of introducing all of the wonderful folks that are here tonight, and Ms. Toni Peters.
Thank you, Dr. Strike, President Harding, and members of the board. Tonight, Brent, would like to recognize our art department. Over time since I've been in this district, you guys have shown a commitment to fine arts, our music programs, and our art programs, and we really, really appreciate that because our kids thrive. Tonight, too, we have brought our artists, their work, and our art teacher, Ms. Shin, who is going to introduce them, and I apologize, they're going to talk really loud. I know they can be loud. So they're going to talk really loud, and they're going to show you some of their artwork and talk about the theme that their art class has been centered around this year. Ms. Shin?
Yes. Good evening. My name is Yuki. I'm the art teacher at Brent Elementary. I would like to introduce my young artists who are excellent. This year our theme for art class is European art. Especially we love French artists, so we are recreating a lot of artwork, famous artwork, in our own translation, and I hope you guys enjoy. First we have kindergartners.
Oh, look, I got the microphone.
Good evening. We are from Brent Elementary School to share our artworks with you. My name is Jordan, I'm 6 years old. I like art because it's fun.
Hi, my name is Alexis. I am 6 years old. I like art because you get to paint.
Hi, my name is Daniela. I'm 6 years old in kindergarten. I like art because you get to make fun and creative stuff.
The Eiffel Tower is in Paris, France. It was built in 1889.
The Eiffel Tower is named after Gustav Eiffel, who designed it.
The Eiffel Tower is 1,050 feet tall.
It weighs about 10,000 tons.
It is repainted every 7 years.
Did you know the Eiffel Tower is painted in 3 different shades of brown?
Kids are going to go ahead and show you their towers, their interpretation of the Eiffel Towers.
Oh,
yeah, that looks great.
All right, let's go on with our first graders, first grader solo. You have a solo tonight. Are you ready? All right.
You want to introduce her?
This is Daniela. She's in first grade, and she's an excellent artist. She will show you her puppet.
This is my puppet. Her name is Elizabeth. And her sparkly dress is really colorful with lots of different kinds of colors, and it's really creative. And her ear bow is a
star. Oh, you don't know where. She lost her earring, it's okay.
Uh-oh, it's over there.
All right, strong. What Miss Yuki did is they created puppets this year and put on readers' theaters in art class that they could do. Oh, we found the earring. Good job. All right, second grade. This is Dominic Ashby.
Hello, my name is Dominic Ashby. I'm 8 years old in second grade. My artwork was on Mona Lisa. What inspired me was my cousin's friend. She had amazing drawings in her book. I wanted to draw it so that like that too, so I tried very hard in my class. What makes my art unique is that the patterns and colors are everywhere. I especially like the Minecraft dog and the logo and my picture. Art means so much to me because it makes me feel accomplished. Thank you.
This is Dominic's work.
Hi, my name is Chelsea. I am in second grade and I am 7 years old. My artwork is about Mona Lisa. I like that my artwork is colorful and pretty. My older sister inspired me to love the beauty of art. All of the colors that are on it and how it's different than the real artwork is what makes my artwork unique. I can show my ideas and my moods through art. This is what art means to me.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Third grade.
Would you like me to hold it?
First, we have Daniel.
Is this your artwork?
I think he's holding his artwork. So, each other's work so they can read their script. Okay. So, this is Daniel's
work. All right, Daniel, go ahead.
My name is Daniel Gibson. I am 9 years old and in the third grade. I like to draw Pokemon characters, sea animals, and many other things. My last school project was the Titanic. I like to draw because it's fun and it makes me happy. I want to encourage others to draw.
And Riley? And this is Riley's work.
My name is Riley Logan. I am 8 years old and in the third grade. Our art lesson was about Van Gogh's Starry Night. What I like about my art is that there is a flower tree instead of a bush. I got inspired to do the wind with many colors because if it is all one color, you cannot know what it is. So I use bright colors so you can see it. I like my art because it has a village and a clock tower, and the bush is now a flower tree. To me, art means that you can take your time and do it your own special way instead of copying someone else.
Thank you, Riley. All right, Chase.
My name is Chase Solinger. I'm age 8 and a half in third grade. My art lesson is about Van Gogh's Starry Night. Looking at his painting, I had the idea to add airplanes to the picture. I put aircraft carriers instead of a village. I also put B-52s on the hill. I love airplanes, so I put it in the picture. Art inspires me, and I hope my art inspires others. I think art means to make something different from everyone than just copying. I like to do art. It's cool and fun. Art is unique like me. Thank you.
Good job, Chase.
My name is Emilio Serrato. I am 9 years old, and I am third grader. Our art lesson was about recreating Van Gogh's masterpiece, Starry Night. My favorite thing about my artwork is that the grass, because it looks 3D, and the stars that are unique. I love art because it makes me happy and I can use my imagination.
Thank you. Thank you, third grade. All right, fourth grade. These guys are very talented. They're also in our honor choir.
Hello, everybody. Let me take you on a magical journey. Wait, I did not do this the right way. Let me introduce myself. My name is Melanie Yoka, and I am in fourth grade, and I am 9 years old. I will be talking about my portrait about me blowing up my ninth birthday cake. We were doing a project on Serrat Dot. We were trying to copy his work with our favorite memory, which on the other hand would be me blowing up my 9th birthday cake. His painting took him 2 years to make his masterpiece. I would like to thank my art teacher, Miss Yuki, for guiding me through this amazing journey. I did my 9th birthday cake because it was a mint Oreo cake and it tasted amazing. Thank you for letting me share this magical journey with you.
Being of this only took me 3 grade levels. Go ahead, Melody.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Melody Chan and I am 10 years old. I am in the 4th grade. This artwork is a recreation of a masterpiece by Saraf the Dot. I like that my artwork is very colorful. It's also very pretty. I got inspired by my art teacher, Miss Yuki. She kept sharing me ideas to make my art better. She didn't rush me, she guided me through the process. She is the best art teacher anyone can ask for. My art is very unique because it's very colorful. I chose to draw this for my 10th birthday. My 10th birthday is very meaningful to me. During my 10th birthday, my friends and family were there. They have made my life a lot better, especially my parents. They have guided me through all 10 years of my life, so that's why I chose to draw this drawing. Thank you and have a wonderful night.
Thank you, 4th grade. And our 5th grade leaders.
Hello.
Luke, go ahead and use the mic.
Hello, my name is Luke DeBlees and I am in 5th grade at Brant Elementary and I'm 11 years old. My art teacher is Miss Yuki. This is how I started my artwork. First, I started tracing for many months, but I wanted to be able to pick up a piece of paper and pencil and be able to draw it myself without tracing. So I started to draw freehand. Here's my first freehand drawing. It's a Pokemon because my brother told me those would be the easiest to draw first. And my second drawing, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh. And as you can see, as I drew freehand more and practiced more, my drawings improved. Here are some of my more advanced drawings. It's a cat and a lion, and they both look very real because they look more like real animals, not like cartoon. And this monkey looks more like a real animal too. But I also like to draw cartoons. Here's a chipmunk that looks like a cute cartoon. I also drew a bunny, a bird, and a puppy. Here are some more examples of some real looking animals. Here's a tiger hanging on a branch and a lobo because I wanted to represent the little home lobos. Here's another cute puppy that wants a really big bone.
Thank you, Luke. Next, we have Abby.
Hello, my name is Abby Lees. I'm 10 years old and in the 5th grade. Just in late December, we did a project about the artwork that a famous artist named Seurat did, or as we call him, Seurat the Dot. This is my artwork. It's a yellow grunt I caught while at Princess K's in the Bahamas on a cruise. It's based off a picture that my mom took of the fish. This fish is special to me because I was the only person who caught a fish there. Plus, it was my first saltwater fish I've caught. That, as you can see, my artwork is made of all dots. It was hard work, but it was worth it. Thank you for your time.
Good job, Abby. Go ahead, Jaden.
Hi, my name is Jaden. I'm 11 years old, and I'm in the 5th grade. In art, we learned how Seurat used pointillism to create his artwork. When making my picture, I wanted to create a place where children can go relax and have fun. So I added the sunset, the picnic, and the girl fishing to demonstrate peaceful activities. I added the tire swing because when I was younger, my cousins and I, would play on the tire swing that was hanging from a gigantic pecan tree in front of a family house that we have. We spent countless hours out there just being kids. Now we act like we're too old for that now, but I really wanted to create that moment. I'm very proud of my picture because it took a while, just as Abby said, but it was worth it. Thank you.
Thank you. And this is just a portion of our artwork. Actually, next week when we at Brent celebrate public schools in Texas, we will be having an art show where you can see all the grade levels artwork. They've done passports to go on this journey. It's a real eclectic group, and I wish I had half the talent in them. I'm still drawing stick figures. They've told me they'll help with that. But along with that, Jaden is going to pass out. We have invitations for each of you to come join us at our art show and showcase next week. So go ahead, Jaden. Thank you, fifth graders.
Tire swings forever.
And I've also been given the opportunity to introduce the Honor Choir tonight. The Honor Choir is the elementary's all auditioned, and so it is an auditioned group with members from each school. As they file in, I will introduce my music teacher, Miss Cassie Currington, and she can tell you any of the details I've left out.
All right, so I am Cassie Currington, I'm a music teacher at Brent. This is the honor choir from all over the district. We've got kids from Brent, raise your hand. We've got kids from Chauvin, raise your hand.
Thank you.
They didn't come to see us. Oh my God, why not?
These people are excited. Stay.
This time I think we'll go ahead and invite Ms. Pentecost up, who will present the Lilium High School Students of the Month Awards. Great photo op, sir.
No, I didn't work today.
Working?
No.
I'll just speak loud.
Thank you.
As President Harmon, board members, and Dr. Strike, it is my pleasure once again to come and introduce you to a couple of our great Little Elm High School students. First off, I would like to invite Donovan Wilson on up here to the front. And then Miranda Gill. Come on up, Miranda. So this is Donovan. Donovan is a sophomore. This is his first year in Little Elm ISD with us. He came to us from LD Bell in Bedford, and he has really fit in very quickly, made lots of friends. He plays in our band. He plays alto sax, and he got a 1 on his solo and a 1 on his ensemble at solo and ensemble contest, and will be advancing to state with his ensemble group. His plans, he would like to go to UT or LSU. He likes dogs a lot, and he wants to volunteer at the local animal shelter. And so Donovan Wilson. Next, I would like to introduce you to Miranda Gill. Miranda is a junior. Miranda is a very busy young lady. She works at Chili's as a hostess and also helps a friend who is a chef on the weekends, serving at parties for him. She currently at the high school is involved in HOSA, and she will be also going to state. She received a first place in her project on personal care. She also participates in DECA and student council. She is in our pharmacy program and eventually wants to go into pediatric nursing. And her plans for her post-secondary education is she wants to start off at a community college to get her basics out of the way. And then she has 3 choices, one of which I think Dr. Strike is really going to like. After that, she's either going to choose Florida University, University of North Texas, or Texas A&M. Miranda Gill. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you.
Very nice time, Mr. Wilson.
Whatever you want.
At this time, I'd like to ask Dr. Cindy Mecca and Ms. Cleota Epps to come forward, and they're going to recognize some of our special community partners, and tonight it's Kroger Marketplace, and Dr. Mecca will be speaking a little bit about Kroger and some of the things they've contributed to the students of Little Elm, as well as our teachers and staff. And Ms. Epps has a little bit of a remembrance to pass out, so they kind of remember the night. And it's some of our student artwork, which is pretty neat because it's one of a kind.
We want to recognize a great community partner, Kroger, and their staff who are extremely supportive of Little Elm ISD. At this time, I'd like to call forward Ignacio Gonzalez, Elizabeth Smith, and Amber Cox.
She was unable to make it, Amber.
Thank you. Here are just a few examples of the support that Kroger and this team have provided to us here at Little Elm. The end of every summer, Kroger holds a regional campaign called Backpack Boosters. It was formerly known as Stuff the Bus. In just the last 3 years, our local Kroger Marketplace has collected and donated nearly $10,000 in school supplies for our Little Elm ISD students. For convocation every year, they cover half the cost of the meals for our employees. And just last month, they donated sandwiches, drinks, chips, and cookies for 250 of our teachers who stayed for charter course. And it's impossible to calculate all the miscellaneous cases of water, paper bags, chips, and every other kind of merchandise that individual schools, athletics, PTAs, and boosters approach them to donate. So thanks, Kroger, and we're Lobo proud. In appreciation, we have artwork for your store created by some of our young Lobos.
When you're ready, we can move on to the report to the superintendent.
The first we have, and actually both of these presentations, is by Matthew Gutierrez, who is our deputy superintendent. He'll talk about Celebrate Texas Public Schools Week, which I think Ms. Peters kind of mentioned a little bit as she got up there, talking about their art and what they're doing during that week. And then he'll flow right into our Destination 2020 quarterly report as an update. Mr. Gutierrez.
In Texas next week, school districts across the state are celebrating Texas public schools. And so we celebrate public schools in Little Elm every day because we believe that we're doing something great every single day for our students. Every moment and every day in Texas public schools, real life engagement and profound learning takes place. This is something that our students and teachers know and do very well. They celebrate these big and little moments as they happen. As a community, we too should be celebrating these moments, and therefore we are inviting our community to many of the events that are taking place next week during Celebrate Texas Public Schools that will be taking place February 29th through March the 4th. On February 29th, on Monday, Lakeview Elementary is holding their first grade choir concert. On March 1st, this is a very busy evening in Little Elm ISD, Brent Elementary, Hackberry Elementary, Chavez Elementary, and Oak Point Elementary are hosting their open house, as well as the high school hosting their junior parent meeting at 5:30. In addition, on March the 1st, Lakeview is holding their curriculum night at 5:30. On Thursday, March the 3rd, Hackberry and Powell Powell is holding their open house. Hackberry's was changed to the 1st. And then on March the 4th, on Friday, Chavez is hosting their grandparent lunch where grandparents are invited to go and have lunch with their grandchildren. Since the approval of the strategic plan back in May of 2015, we have committed to providing quarterly reports to the Board of Trustees so that you can see and hear about the progress that we're making on our five-year strategic plan, Destination 2020.
Mr. Gutierrez, can I interrupt you just real quick? Before we go with that, we have Mr. Doug Peach here with the proclamation on Public Schools Week, so I'll let Mr. Peach.
Sorry.
That's all right. Thank you, Matthew.
I As stated, I'm Doug Peach, the deputy town manager for the town of Little Elm, and on behalf of Mayor David Hillock, I would like to read a proclamation to celebrate Texas public schools. Whereas the students of our state's public school hold the promise of a successful future in their capable hands, and whereas the Little Elm Independent School District provides the tools, framework, and solid foundation that is vital towards the future of our children, and whereas the dedicated efforts of parents, educators, and community leaders will provide the necessary support and strength to our public schools, providing our children a quality education. And whereas students will attain a higher level of achievement because of the commitment to excellence and focus on continued improvement in our public schools, and therefore, I, Mayor David Hillock of the town of Little Elm, do hereby proclaim March 2016 as the month to celebrate Texas public schools. We urge all citizens to support the theme, Public Education, a Texas Tradition, by taking the time to learn more about the history of their district's local schools and campuses. And I have a great copy.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Peach served on this committee to our Destination 2020 committee, so that's a nice time for you to visit.
Give a little update.
Absolutely, on your work.
Just to go through a little bit of background, we started with the community forums early last spring, and then went on in March to meet with the Strategic Planning Committee, who defined the core values, which are at the center of everything that we do. And so I'm going to be revisiting those core values today and be talking to you about how we were able as a school district to define and dig in a little deeper to share what the core values mean to us. So what we did over the beginning of the school year in August, when the employees came back from their summer break, is the campuses and the departments here at Zellers worked with the principals and department supervisors, worked with their staff to define our core values, to share what they meant to them. And then once that took place, then we had a group of superintendent leadership team members who then worked to combine all of that information that was taken from the campuses and departments and define our core values. What we did find in going through all of that information is that there were so many similarities. And so it did not take a lot of effort to be able to combine all of that information from the various campuses and departments because they were so similar. So the core values, the five core values that were created by the strategic planning team back in the spring, were that we, as Lobos, we value a culture founded on the highest qualities of character, unleashing every individual's highest potential, creating a community where every student loves to learn, every teacher loves to teach, and every person is proud to call home, a foundation of culture that values unity and pride, embracing all of our kids as all of our kids, and open, transparent, and timely communication. So once our family was able to come back together in August, there was time to get to know their principals, get to know central office admin, and really get to understand what we were all about. So by the time that our family members came back from the summer, they were really able to come together and work through what the core values meant to them. And so as a result, I'm going to read what is now posted on our website on the Strategic Planning Destination 2020 page. As Lobos, we value a culture founded on the highest qualities of character, and what that means is excellence, integrity, respect, and compassion. As Lobos, we value unleashing every individual's highest potential. That means we promote high expectations, we inspire creativity, we nurture self-confidence, and we commit to accountability. As Lobos, we value creating a community where every student loves to learn, every teacher loves to teach, and every person is proud to call home, a foundation of culture that values unity and pride. We provide a safe and supportive environment. We expand opportunities for achievement. We support collaboration. We promote district identity and culture. We praise and celebrate success, and we are Lobo proud. If you notice, that's a hashtag we use quite frequently, and many times we sign off on social media and even in text with one another. As Lobos, we value embracing all of our kids as all of our kids. We champion success. We ignite passion. We value and encourage every student. We foster relationships, and we cultivate ownership. As Lobos, we value open, transparent, and timely communication. Communication that's honest, clear, respectful, courteous, engaging, and proactive. I hope that as you were listening and reading the core values, that you've been able to see that that is something that we are really trying to live by in our district, from a custodial worker to a paraprofessional to an assistant superintendent. As I read through that, each one of them has so much meaning, because I truly believe that we are really making a hard effort to live by those every day, although there are still challenges. But the great thing is that when one violates those core values, that we feel comfortable enough to have that discussion, because we want to all model what our core values mean to us. And working with the team to share and transitioning to the progress we're making to our goals, was pretty overwhelmed with everything that is taking place, and had to share with the team, we've got to narrow it down to just 2 to 4 things. I can't have 20, because I could easily have 100 slides to share with the board, to share all of the great things that we're doing and the progress we're making, but we don't have that time. But I feel that because of a lot of the communication that is taking place, that you're able to see, hear, and read about a lot of the progress that is taking place that is aligned to the strategic plan. So I'm going to start with one of the first things, and I'm not going to go through and read all of the details, but the first goal that I'm referring to is pertains to recruitment, retention, and engagement, and committing to engaging and engage in recruiting and retention practices that will ensure that each employee is well matched to expectations of their role and the district's values, and just some of the things that the Human Resource Department is doing. They have already, in this school year, met separately with Denton ISD, Frisco ISD, Mansfield ISD, Garland ISD, and Wiley ISD to identify and compare models related to best practices, and then take some of their ideas and put them into place rather quickly. The human resource team has established a standard, consistent hiring and onboarding process. The process has made it easier for the applicant to access and apply to open positions, and has greatly updated and improved the accessibility to onboarding documents, which are all electronic. Human Resource Services has created an electronic workflow, which greatly improved the onboarding process and reduced paper consumption. And utilizing neighboring school districts as a support, we can now say that the onboarding process, from coming on board to exiting, is completely electronic. We have done away with paper, including at the time when someone resigns, they complete that electronically, and they also complete a survey. Once they resign, they automatically get a survey that where we can automatically get feedback on why people are leaving us and better serve our employees. Our school district, I'm very proud to say for the first time, Little Elm ISD is going to host the North Central Texas Association of School Personnel Administrators on March the 30th, and they have invited student teaching director from UNT as the guest speaker. So this is approximately there are many districts because we span from west of Fort Worth all the way to Tyler. So there are over 100 school districts, and so we have invited all of those school districts to come and learn about HR here in Little Elm. We're very excited about that opportunity. In continuing with the same goal in recruitment and retention, we are very proud that our substitute daily rate was increased across the board by $10 a day, and even another creative method that many districts have talked about, but we've been able to put into action, is the additional $10 supplement for Mondays and Fridays, which are our most critical days. This has resulted in increased substitute fill rates across the district, where we were really struggling the last couple of years, struggling significantly in the fall. We have been able to consistently fill all jobs, although we do have some challenges when we have days where we're training large numbers of teachers. This has really made a huge impact, and the more people we can get in, and then they can see the great things that we're doing in the district, and then they spread that, tell our story to the community, the better. We have a competitive starting teacher salary of $48,000 and $49,500 for a master's. When it comes to teaching and learning, engaging each student in rigorous, relevant learning experiences, campus and district leadership have been providing ongoing embedded professional learning to build capacity as instructional leaders. Through the collaborative instructional review cycles, we have observed, calibrated, and coached together at every single campus this school year. Continuing and engaging our students in rigorous, relevant learning experiences, our professional learning surveys have been revamped to include the evaluation of teacher progress toward the specific learning target. So just as we expect teachers to have learning targets for students, the expectation in the curriculum department is that we have a learning target for the teachers that we are teaching, and then they provide us with feedback on how they feel about themselves reaching the learning target. The data is used to determine the content and training resources that need to be provided for teachers. This is just an example of feedback from one of the most recent professional learning opportunities regarding the rigor rubric, and you can see that for the first question, I can explain the rigor rubric to a colleague, that over 77% feel pretty confident about being able to explain the rigor rubric to our colleagues. So that goes to show that the training that we have been involved in with ICLE and that the work that our curriculum department is doing with teachers through cadres and the professional learning opportunity here itself has really been effective based on the feedback. Continuing with engaging students in rigor, we have been able to identify areas of need, rigor and relevance. Teachers from each campus volunteer to dig deeper with the learning and lead their campus conversations around our work with rigor and relevance framework. In PBL, we have started PBL Coaches Academy, consisting of teachers, principals, assistant principals, digital learning facilitators, and a Zellers team, and we are working to support teachers on our trained campuses. So we are training teachers to be PBL coaches on their campuses. Continuing with rigor and relevant learning experiences, all administrators have had at least 10 days of professional learning that focuses on the resources and calibration tools for rigorous learning. So far this school year, 10 days of professional learning that every single assistant principal and principal have gone through to ensure that they can have those conversations regarding rigor and relevance with teachers. Continuing with engagement, we will provide training and implementation and support rigorous and engaging instruction at the campus level, utilizing the rigor and relevance framework. And this is just an example of something that's happening on the campus where teachers are sharing what they go into a classroom, a colleague's classroom, and they look at the lesson and they determine what level of rigor it is, and then they share out. So this is just an example from a campus. As far as communications, LEISD will effectively communicate with all stakeholders. One example of progress is that the communications department has agreed with the town of Little Elm to launch a community shared website called My Little Elm News to create a one-stop shop for community news. The MOU is currently in process and the web design company has been selected, and we're looking at a target date of the next school year being in July or August. Something else that's very exciting, an agreement has been signed with the consultant to help reestablish the 501c3 of the Little Elm ISD Education Foundation. The timeline is to begin making teacher grants by the end of 2016. And that is just a snippet of the progress that is being made. And one of the things that we do make sure when we're making decisions about what we're going to do, whether it's looking at a resource, a program, initiative, is that everything is tied to the strategic plan that has, thankfully, with your support, been approved. And we are making huge gains as we progress through year one of year five.
Matthew, thank you for that presentation. I think that kudos go to the board for allowing us a year ago to move forward with the strategic planning. What you see up there, what he just shared, and the amount of work that's been done by a tremendous number of people in this district from the campus up through administration levels has been amazing. If we hadn't have done that, we would be a year behind. So I really appreciate the board stepping forward and saying, yeah, jump in and get that planning on the way, because we would now be today probably bringing you the plan to share, and everything which he just showed you highlights literally could have had 100 slides of things that are going on, and again, all the way from the campus level throughout the entire organization. And then I think our core values has helped us to the whole thing about all our kids are all our kids. The number of times I bet I hear that weekly, and we even get people who send emails going, hey, here's another example of all our kids are all our kids, mean that the kids at Brent and the kids at Chavez and any other campus, they all belong to all of us. And folks here have really embraced that. And I think that, again, the board should be proud of yourselves for allowing us to move forward with that.
And I think that the great thing is, and I turn this off, is people within the district, our employees, look for opportunities to help others on different campuses, and that's something that we see happening so often. And I think it's because it's become so ingrained that all of our kids are all of our kids, that now people are looking for opportunities. Just a quick example, all sixth grade students taking an online assessment at Powell, and we have the NJHS sponsor sending students to go and work and provide oral reading small group accommodations because there's a shortage of staff to be able to do that. That's just one example. But this is happening every day, and it's great, and it's a win-win. Those students have an opportunity to mentor, and the Cal students have an opportunity to have positive role models to look up to. So those are opportunities that our employees are looking for every day, and it's just a great thing to be able to witness.
I had the honor and privilege of actually participating in the creation of the plan, and I know, you know, prior to having that plan, we were kind of a little lost, kind of jumping all over the place, trying to take care of things. So I got to thank Mr. English for his leadership and helping spearhead to get that started, and then Dr. Strike's ability to take us through the process was just absolutely amazing. So, and just seeing that, and I can't believe it's been a year. Ms. Myers, we got to be a part of that. Mr. Peach, we had several days there where it was really enlightening, and it was a great opportunity. So I was glad to be a part of it. So thank our leaders, Dr. Strike and Mr. English, for getting us there. And God, it has been a year. Time flies.
It flies when you're having fun.
Yes, it does. And great job, Mr. Gutierrez. Thank you.
Thank you all. And I also want to thank the staff and Dr. Strike and others in the community and people who are all involved, because it took just a lot of effort from everyone, from the board members who supported us and the things moving forward, and the staff and getting things together and the city as well, and the leadership. This was important, really, really important for our community. It was important for our kids, and it was important for our staff. We wanted a district that people would love to be at. We wanted a community that people would love to be at. And this was an important step to get us in that direction, and very proud, and I want to thank you for all your hard efforts.
All righty. Well, at this time, we will recess into closed session as permitted by the Texas Open Meetings Act, subchapter .074 and .072 at 7:39. All right, we will reconvene back into open session at 8:43. First item up for discussion is to discuss and approve the amendment to the MOU with the town of Little Elm. Mr. Roberts?
Oh, thank you. And yeah, that sounds good. Can everybody hear me?
Yes, sir.
President Harding, Board of Trustees, Dr. Strike, thank you. And good evening. And it is my portion of tonight is to look at the amendment to our current MOU with the town of Little Elm pertaining to SROs. And so as we spoke last board meeting, there was a third SRO discussed. So what I have done for you tonight, number one, is that you have a separate undercover document in front of you that I see most of you are looking at now, which has specifics. But what I'm going to take a couple of minutes and do is go over two slides, which basically will be the two options that we have created, because after our discussion of the last board, we wanted to talk about options and bring those back to you and put those in front of you, because we support what you guys are deciding to do in terms of SRO. So to recap what we talked about last time are the different options. And so what we put together for you is option one, which basically is two additional officers, which is two added to the current MOU, which comes out to four school resource officers. So option one is four school resource officers. Please remember that LEISD is 75% of the officers' salaries. LEISD is 50% of the officers' training. You can read that next piece there, that we will split cost with the PD, and it'll be 50% of the training that is specific to our SROs in our part of school liaison program. One SRO will be housed at the high school, one SRO housed at Powell. And they'll cover elementary campuses. That's option one, which is a total of four SROs. Option two will be an additional three SROs, which will be bring our total to five school resource officers. Again, same details, 75% of salary, 50% of the training, but it's important to see where we have those SROs placed. One SRO housed at the high school, same as option one. One SRO housed at Powell, supervises and collaborates with SROs, which we'd figure we are getting a sergeant or a corporal, and that person, he or she, will supervise and work with all of the SRO program. And then one SRO covers elementary campuses. Those are the two options that stemmed from our last board meeting. One piece of information I might add that you can see at the bottom of your separate undercover sheet is that the difference between the two options is $59,964. So that's the difference between four SROs and five SROs. Also in the separate undercover, you can see the amount that we're looking at from the fund balance from the 2015-2016 school year. And then you can see the amount and the details, quarterly payment that we have directed to the 16-17 annual budget. Any questions at this time?
On the page you have for the 17-18 annual budget for the squad cars, so that would come out 2 years or next year? The annual budget, or should that be 16-17?
Are you looking at the very bottom?
Yeah, the very bottom.
The very bottom is just to let each of you know that in 17-18, the budget will be dropped $91,000.
Okay.
Because typically those cars will really be close to a seven-year cycle because they're really not on the beat in picking up the mileage that a normal police car does.
But these are the ones that we're talking about to go with this?
Yes.
Okay.
I just wanted that in there to see the drop. Any other questions?
I just divided out, just sitting here, took Mr. Roberts' number of 59,964, rounded it to 60,000, divided that by the number of students, this is to give the board a perspective, divided it by 7,200 student population, which will actually be bigger than that. It's just a little over $8 a child for that extra officer. When sometimes it helps to break things down per kid or per staff member, whatever. That's $8.
I was just going to ask, and this would start for the 16-17 school year? Or would it start immediately?
Yes, the overall program that I have on the slides would start for the 16-17 school year.
Okay.
Okay. However, if you look on your cover, undercover, and you look to the left, and you see the 150,000, that does have in place, which we figured that we will have an officer on campus at the high school for 56 days, which is the number of days that we have left in the remainder of this school year. And Chief Harrison has committed to that and would help having another body in the building to give us extra support until this whole plan kicks into place 16-17. I don't think there's not anybody in the room that wants to say this starts 16-17 and then something happens. So we wanted to get an extra body in place until it kicks in.
I thought I remembered that. I just wasn't sure.
Uh-huh.
Sorry.
Just one extra body right now.
Or right now. In our biggest population, most active population. That way we'll always have an SRO on campus.
Right. Okay.
So did the 150 also include the two squad cars or vehicles?
No, actually, because of the quarterly payment, and you can help me with this too, we've moved that over into the annual budget. That's over on the right-hand side of your undercover document. So in 16-17 annual budget, if you look there, it's 50-50 with LAPD. And I put that in there because it really is splitting those squad cars with the police department.
So what are the additional costs? If it's 56 days of 75% of an officer's salary, what's the rest? What makes up the rest of the $150,000?
It comes out to, I had it broken down, the quarterly payment, which is the agreement with the PD, which you can see, which will be the 107. So that's in addition to the 56 days is 16-8. And then just startup costs like with computers, things of that nature.
So Mr. Roberts, is it not correct? The 150 is not what it's costing for the 56 days. That's the quarterly payment,
which
includes all the other two SROs that are already on staff.
The 150 is a number that will cover the quarterly payment, which is the payment that the PD needs at that time to be able to have the officers in place. It also includes the 56 days of that extra officer and then soft startup cost.
So originally it was 107,
right. But it's so now we're paying a quarter payment now.
It's about a $43,000.
Right.
Delta.
Yeah. That is correct.
Okay.
Wouldn't that already be in the budget?
All but the $43,000. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
So not the
107 is in the budget already.
Okay.
Yes, $43,000 additional.
Just for right now, and then this is for?
16-17.
16-17, uh-huh. I have the quarterly payment that'll be for the 16-17 annual budget there.
Board, have any other questions of Mr. Roberts?
And administration will support what direction you guys want. If there's no further questions, the administration recommends the approval of the amendment to MOU-ILA-SRO agreement with the town of Little Elm. The administration supports the addition of 3 SROs to increase the safety and security of LAISD students and staff.
So moved.
We've got to make the motion first.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
So, well, we've got to make, I have to make the motion. So as a quick discussion with the board. Okay, I know what I'm going to do. Because we can always make amendments if we change our mind, so. I need a motion to approve the amended MOU-ILA-SRO agreement with the town of Little Elm. The administration supports the addition of 3 SROs to increase the safety and security of LAISD students and staff.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Any discussion?
So we're going to option 2, if I understand this correct?
The motion currently is for 3 SROs.
3 additional SROs, so it's option 2.
Yes, sir.
Yes, which would provide one for the high school, one for the middle school, and you said one of a higher level that would be like a supervisor?
That would be correct.
Okay. So one would be a POW, a supervisory role, another one would be for elementary campuses.
We haven't determined just yet where that person would be, but we would think centrally located to be able to service elementary campuses the easiest.
And I think something important to point on that, I had a conversation with Chief Harrison just to clear with Oak Point and Hackberry, the fact that the service, the MOU is to serve our campuses, that allows those, any of those officers, and particularly this one, to be able to serve our Oak Point children as well as our Hackberry children.
That was actually one of my questions is with, I mean, like the Colony for the Tribute or and the Prestwick School, we had to go with them. I was going to ask, having a third floater, will that cause any issues with Oak Point or Hackberry?
I don't anticipate any issues with that. We do interlocal agreements all the time where we're paid to provide a service. We currently do that right now. Technically, Hackberry is in the county. A lot of times there's not a county deputy available, so we end up, you know, our orders are we go over there and hold down the fort till the county gets there. A lot of times we resolve the issue for there and show up. So, you know, we intend to do that. We do the same thing. We don't get called to Oak Point very often, but when we do go over there and try to resolve the situation. And we work with, you know, our counterparts the best we can to make it a smooth situation.
And I think there was even an instance here in the last 8 days or so where Little Elm PD, you know, provided service to one of those campuses to help with the situation.
Yes, sir. That is correct.
Okay. Oak Point sits in the county?
No. Oak Point is in the city of Oak Point.
Oh, that's right. Hackberry sits in the county.
Yeah,
that's right.
So
Hackberry sits in the city, but that's this county association, right?
That's correct. It's in the county. So, but they're kind of, you know, it's hard to get to them, and deputies are spread out all across the county. Right. So we're their closest resource. Okay. So a lot of times the principal will just call us direct. Okay. We respond over there and handle the situation.
Thank you.
No, ma'am.
You made the motion. Who seconded the motion?
I made the motion. David seconded.
Okay.
Mr. Williams, do you have any questions?
Yes, I do.
No, my question was just, so with the option 2, we're adding 3 additional officers. We currently already have 2. Utilizing 2 vehicles, adding 3 officers. Are we going to add 2 more vehicles now, or are we waiting?
Yes, we're going to add two. If that's the direction the board is going, we would add 2. There is an agreement with Chief Harrison and the PD that third officer, mm-hmm. Their fleet is depleted down to nothing. I think there is a vehicle in which that they can do a checkout system, mm-hmm. where that third officer will report and get that vehicle if it's available If not, then they'll have to have a buddy system. So, you know, that kind of gives some more information about the three SROs. So yes, there'll be two cars, but just two, not a third.
Are you wondering, are those going to be, we wouldn't have two new cars now, we'd have two new cars later.
It would be 16, 17.
Will be the two new cars.
That is correct.
So the third officer for the 54 days.
The 54 days, they're handling that where the squad car that the officer has now will be what they use.
Okay.
That is correct.
So essentially, the third is not going to get an issued car the same as next year, and then the two new ones will come next year with the two additional.
That is correct.
Okay, so say, for example, I have two officers at the high school, right? And this is semantics, but how many vehicles are at the high school with two officers?
There'll be two cars.
There'll be two, okay.
Yes.
All right, and same with the junior high?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That was it.
Yeah.
So I want to clarify with the job description. If we have an individual that is a floater, and Dr. Strike, you may be able to answer this as well. We have one SRO that's assigned kind of as a floater. What would it, as we grow and possibly need to assign them to an individual campus for any reason, is there any complications with that, or do we change things as we need it?
I think we just adjust as we need it with Chief Harrison and the town PD in terms of what the service areas are, because they have their ideas of what's needed for security and safety, and if we have something, it's a matter of getting together and have a conversation what's best for our kids.
Okay, so having three of these, or five total, enough, three new ones on our team, we'll be able to.
And while we're growing numbers-wise, we're not growing so fast that we're going to outgrow this quickly. I mean, I don't think it's going to be in 2 years, hey, are we looking at another, what are we going to do? I think we're talking about quite a ways down the road before we'd have to look at an additional officer.
But because of the growth or needs, if we need to adjust where we have one located, I think the partnership that we've created with Chief Harrison and the PD, or that we have, that we're continuing to move down that direction, we'll be able to discuss that and do whatever we need to take care of the kids.
We'd have to have another meeting, bring them back.
We need them over here.
No, okay. I don't think so.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Montmeyer, any questions? Ms. Myers? Good. So are we good with three? Any concerns? I'm going to call for the vote. So all those in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you.
And I think just from an administrative standpoint, I think I'm talking for our superintendent's leadership team. I think that what the board just did in protecting our children, the number one thing that all parents want, the number one thing you want, the number one thing we want, is for our kids to be as safe as we possibly can. And we know all we got to do is turn on the news and see what a crazy world we live in. So anything that we can do, and I think that this is a move that just strengthens that I think our community would have great great support for, and the board's direction that you just took. And I think the more we've developed a relationship with Chief Harrison, the PD, they're a class outfit, and they've got the best interest of our kids at heart too. So I know that it's going to be a positive relationship. So
it really is. And I know a couple of times it was mentioned last board member about the work that's already being noticed in terms of safety and security. And so by these steps tonight, you know, thank you for that support. It's going to allow us to do some really amazing things to take care of the safety of our children. So we really appreciate this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts. Before this, one of my personal things of making sure that our kids are safe.
Absolutely.
Some things we got to work on. So this is really lovely.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Harrison.
Mr. Reeves is up next to discuss and approve the real estate sales contract between Little Elm Independent School District and the town of Little Elm.
Thank you, Ms. Hart, and board members, and Dr. Strike. Just here to talk to you about the sale of the operational services property to the town of Little Elm. What we presented to you in closed session was the sale of King property for the $1 million. And then we also talked about the improvements over near our new operational services facility, $1.5 million, and also any abatement costs when we sell that property as is to the town of Little Elm, that they would incur those abatement costs. And so the total of that would equal the fair market value that we got from the two appraisals, which were required to present that to y'all. Also, as part of that agreement, we would do a lease agreement with our transportation facility, because we would need to build our new facility, which will take 18 months to be able to do that. And so they allow us to stay there for those 18 months until we move into our new facility. So that was pretty quick. I'll be happy to answer any questions you may have on that.
Questions here?
We'll go ahead and make a motion to approve the real estate sales contract buy-in between Little Elm Independent School District and the town of Little Elm, Texas, and the lease agreement as submitted.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. Okay. So do we have any questions, discussion? Okay. I'll call for the vote. All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you all so much.
Thank you.
And again, I'd just like to commend Rod. He's put a lot of time and effort into this, and working with the town folks, as well as going back and forth between attorneys and making adjustments and looking at appraisals. So just thank you, Rod, for your hard work on that.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Reeves. All right, so we will move on to the consent agenda. Anything, any questions, anything need to be pulled? Are we good?
Okay.
So I need a motion to approve the consent agenda.
So moved.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Any opposed? Motion carries. So we'll move on to the comments for me. All right, it's my portion. I get to talk now. I'll make it very, very brief, very quick. Tonight we made some more changes in the headway in the right direction. We're growing again. We're changing. So this is a very exciting time. I really can't wait to see this stuff happen next year and as we're growing. So I want to thank you guys for all the hard work y'all put into all the numbers. And the person that was here to help us with all the money, he already left, so I don't get to thank him. Tell him thank you for me. Anyway, thank you guys for everything that y'all have done. So this is great. So, all right, so we will now move on to board comments.
What? Jesse's here.
Oh, Jesse's here? Where is he? Oh,
yeah.
Sorry. Thank you, Jesse, for everything, for the information that you pulled together for us tonight. So thank you. Okay, so we'll move on to board comments. So Mr. Olson, do you have any comments?
Yes, I want to once again thank all of the schools. I was not here at the last meeting, so I apologize due to illness. But thank you once again all of the schools for all the great signs for Board Appreciation Month in January. That was awesome, plus all the gifts. Laundry list here of accolades. Congratulations to the girls basketball team. Did a great playoff run. I was there at the game. Thank you for Mr. Gutierrez. Mr. Lohman was there. Sonia was there. I know Ms. Pentecost was there. I probably can go on and on and on. So all the staff are traveling to Garland. That was awesome to see the participation, all the fans going there. Looking forward to hopefully a long run for the boys, hopefully starting here pretty soon. Congratulations to Winter Guard. I know they've been in a bunch of competitions lately. They've been doing tremendous. I saw first place and a third place, I believe. Mm-hmm. So they're continuing theirs. Band is doing great with all the solos and ensembles. And on top of that, we turn around and go to track, softball, and baseball. Mm-hmm. So it's an exciting time right now at the district. All of our kids choir, shout out to choir, because choir is doing excellent too. So I know we just had some plays at the middle school and the high school. So things are always going well. So congratulations to all those groups, and continue to keep up the good work.
Well, add DECA going to state.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Well, I knew there was one in there. I couldn't remember all of them. We got so much. So. But congratulations to all the teams. They're doing excellent. So proud of all of them. Hashtag Lobo proud.
Thank you, Mr. Olson. Mr. English.
Oh, yeah, cool, Mr. Olson. Hashtag Lobo proud. And also, particularly to the girls' basketball team. A couple of girls I coached when they were much, much younger. Oh. And it's nice to see them go off and play that now. So it's nice to get up there and see those kids play. So next year is going to be an emotional part for me because I think we're going to be torn in two districts. Look forward to it.
Ms. Myers?
No comments.
Ms. Mayor?
I just want to thank the hard work of everybody that was involved tonight in the SRO discussions and negotiations and the negotiations of the building. There's definitely steps, you know, forward in the safety of the school and also just the financial stability of the school going forward as well. So I want to thank everybody for their hard work on that.
Mr. Williams?
No, thank everybody for the hard work that you've done. Pulling the numbers together, coming back with the presentation on the SRO. Thank you for your time and coming to talk to us about it. One of the things that haven't been on the board for just a little while is there was a time where we used to just all say approve, 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 and not ask a lot of questions and not push back and not challenge. The challenge is not that we want to disagree. The challenge is that we want people to know that we're being considerate with their monies and with their and how we're thinking about it. But one of the things that made it real for me in my decision-making process is when Dr. Strike said it's $8 additional. I'm like, okay, so how can I not approve $8 per child when really every child is invaluable, right? So we can find the additional $8 of what we were going to do, even though we were thinking about it anyway, but that just made it real. So I appreciate that gut check there. And in addition, also continue doing a great job because I love engage, equip, and empower. I actually use that with my new team because I think it's so powerful that you can just take that message and run with it. And Lobo proud as well with that message. So proud of you guys. Keep doing what you're doing.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Williams. All right, Dr. Strike.
Well, you know, I think just all our kids are all our kids, that core value. I think what's neat about that is that holds true for our board as well as all of our staff and in our community. And I think that's great, and extending that to whether it's the police department or the town working with us, or it's a nice atmosphere to work in. And when that happens, it's best for kids. And I think the comment that Mr. Williams made about, you know, pushing back or asking questions, that makes us all better. Questions always make us stop and think and make us better. So as an administration, we appreciate that. And again, just that if there's anything that you all need ever as a board, our whole thing is transparency. So we want to make sure you have all the information. It's the correct information. We answer your questions. So never hesitate to make sure you have what you need to be of service to our community and ultimately to our kids. Different events that Mr. Olson mentioned. Gosh, it's just, you know, you think about athletics and the fall being busy, but it's really the spring that breaks loose, and then we've got all kinds of great fine arts stuff going on that we've kind of touched on a little bit, and there's some awards in our visual arts that we're going to be mentioning a little bit later on, as some folks that participated in the first time in a visual arts contest, and we have kids already going to state. We've talked about our ACADEC. It's really neat just to see the enthusiasm, excitement of our kids, and a lot of times it's just a matter of giving kids an opportunity. You saw the from kindergartners to fifth graders come up here and speak and share, and you look at their talents, and one of the things we want to do is that uniqueness of individuals. We want to make sure there's something in this district for every child to be able to fully explore what they want to explore in terms of growing, whether it's cognitively, social, emotional, being parts of clubs, organization, or through athletics, the physical part that we get. Again, looking at our website, you know, I just keep referring people back to that because there's a lot of great things happening there. And then I'll just end with this. I mentioned it briefly before, but Ms. Keisha Brown, our college and career counselor at the high school. This is a letter that we received from Texas A&M. Congratulations, my pleasure to inform you, written to Ms. Brown, of your selection as a 2016 Very Important Counselor for Texas A&M University. The Very Important Counselor Program recognizes the outstanding service and important work of high school counselors, teachers, personnel on their path to college. You're among a few chosen for this prestigious program. Her participation in this program carries with it a $1,000 scholarship to Texas A&M University for the fall of 2016. The student from Little Elm High School will be chosen by Ms. Brown and Ms. Pentecost. And then she'll be visiting Texas A&M University, where she'll be part of a program, be able to receive this award. All costs paid, transportation, hotel, all meals, is one of the very important counselor awardees. So we've got great kids doing great things, but I think just like the art or the choir that you heard sing, it takes engaged staff before you can ever have engaged kids. And that's what I find throughout this district is people that are engaged at high levels that want to do great things for kids. And sometimes it's just a matter of opening the door and giving an opportunity for the staff as well as for kids. And so that's what we're trying to do is flatten things down organizationally so that people can come forward with great ideas and do some neat things. And there are a lot of good things that happen. You know, if you look at a lot of things that happen in business, they always talk about, you know, empowering the bottom and kind of that bottom top up thing. However, if you will study it, 90% come from top down. And the reason it comes from top down is that while people talk about empowering the bottom, the top still makes all the decisions. And we're trying to really work hard. We're not there, but we're trying to really work hard to flatten it so that our folks come up with great ideas. And I know Matthew talked to you about a couple different things that he's doing. The art, for example, we're going to do a spring art show. They said when I got here, I asked, what do we do for an art show? And they said, well, we don't have one. So why are we excluding those kids from being able to come out and share in their visual arts? So Matthew's coordinating that and had overwhelming support from the art teachers that his meeting went longer than expected because they were enthusiastic about that. And then he talked to you about the Lobo Cares program, which is, again, pushing down to our staff. And we really truly want a top-down, bottom-up collaboration to do what's very best for our kids. And when you can make decisions as close to the point of implementation as you can, you usually get a better decision, and leadership helps to guide that and open those doors. And that's starting to happen. We're not where we need to be, but it's starting to happen. So good things are going to happen as we continue down the road. So it takes strong leadership, and it takes not management, but leadership, and it takes people that are willing to become engaged, and those people are already here. They just had to be opened up and given an opportunity. So exciting place to be.
All right, well, thank you very much. It's been an exciting night, so I need a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Have a motion, second?
Second.
All those in favor? All right. Meeting adjourned at 9:15.
Oh, man.